I'm going to be talking about Blender 2.5. Maybe some of you have heard of that. It's our next big thing. Well, most of it is that nobody knows what we're talking about, and people think it's going to be like the second coming of Blender, like maybe the Obama of Blender. So yeah, I'm going to try to clarify some things. So Blender 2.5 mostly is a recode of all our core functions, like our event systems, window manager, tool API, and maybe a bit of UI. Well, it's going to happen anyway. And why is this going to happen? Because, well, first of all, what used to happen in the current Blender function is for event management, mostly, if I'm talking too fast, just someone do that, because I tend to do that in presentations. So what currently happened in Blender is that we have one big switch function with event keys that then checks if control or shift are pressed, and then it calls a function. So like no flexibility at all, no customizability, no extensibility. It's just like no good, right? So the tool API recode is mostly for that, and also for reusability of macros. So what we're doing is recoding everything into nice little boxes that can be reused and plugged in together and chained and macros and all of that fun stuff. All right? So how are we going to do that? Well, some people are working till they drop, which mostly Campbell, if you're looking at that, go to sleep now. All right? And we've got two people working full-time on that code, Brecht van Lommel and Ton Rosendahl. Ton is the head of the Blender Foundation, and Brecht is a full-time coder working for them. And I didn't change the slide properly. So yeah. Yeah, so and all of the work is also done by a part-time coder like myself and other guys all around the world. So it's going to happen at some point. It's happening right now. It's a process that started, I think, now 1.5 years ago that mostly solidified because of Winter Camp. Winter Camp was a three-day workshop in Amsterdam March this year organized by the Institute of Network Culture. Basically, it was a big powwow of artist networks to socialize and talks and get things done. So what we did is we did a lot of technical design. We decided on, well, up there you have everyone that participated from all around the globe. So we discussed Blender UI paradigm, technical design. We draw a lot of the UI design rules, and we discussed all those kinds of fun stuff with window manager and editor reviews. The Blender UI paradigm is something that's, well, I would say completely the opposite of GIMP. GIMP has all those distributed windows everywhere and that kind of stuff. Blender's UI is based on non-overlapping windows, which is totally different. So what we have is one big screen and separations everywhere. So we're moving a bit away from that for 2.5, or not too away from that, but we want to have better support for dual screen. And what that means is you can clone windows, have separate windows, and then put your toolbars or whatever you want on your second monitor, say half of it, and have your main windows on your main monitor. That's much more flexible than what currently happens, which just means you can maximize the Blender UI on both, and then it doesn't line up properly, and you're stuck, and people bitch about it, with reasons. All right, so at Winter Camp, we had those big boards filled with design, so we brewed over that and did all kinds of fun stuff, and then people got to implement it, all right? So yeah, so we worked, and we socialized. So as you can see, we had some big projectors, we did some fun stuff, and lots of thinking, lots of arguing, obviously. So what's happening is we've got this nice mailing list called Task Force 2.5. When people come to discuss mockups, do a lot of functionality discussions, core rewrite discussion, like what's going to happen with our internal tool API, what's going to happen with our Python API. Yes, we are going to break our Python API for 2.5. So everyone has got plugins down there. You can cry a bit because you have to recode them, but you can be happy because the API is going to be much more cleaner, and you'll have direct access to tools. So if you want to call the subdivide function is going to be accessible to you. You won't have to muck around with the vertices yourself. And we've got also some people talking wild stuff like, let's do a Java rewrite. That's not going to happen, but why not? All right. So yeah, I've got some mock-up example there. These are mostly done by William Rainish from Denmark. So that's something I think he did for WinterCam. So by hand, I think he's using a vector application, probably Inkscape or, God forbid, Illustrator. So this is something that could happen. So what's happening is that we've got this nice API, Access API, on top of our data API. So we can do all kinds of funky stuff. This is all, hopefully, UI based on Python, which is currently happening. So we can define all those Python rules to say, these are the properties I want you to display. Display it in this box. And then it's going to automatically do select, depending on the property type, if it's a checkbox, if it's a dropdown, if it's a slide button, and fun stuff like that. That's another one. That's a preference window mockup, which is similar to what we have now. Not a lot of interesting stuff going on in this one, I guess. What time is it? Ooh, maybe slow down a little bit. All right, so technical details. What's happening in 2.5? 2.5, we've got, as I said, the operator tool pack. Operators basically is wrapping all the core functions, so like subdivide as an operator, moving stuff around as an operator, any kind of operation, manipulation of data as an operator. And what that means is the operator has defined parameters, that's the range of parameters, and basically it's a defined function that can be wrapped in API really easily, automatically, actually. And then we've got RNA. For people that aren't in the know, the Blender data API, core data definition with structs in C, is called sDNA for structured DNA. What that does is it basically defines every kind of structure, data structure in Blender, encodes it in a very, very large strings, put that in the binary and in the file. So when you load a really, really old Blender file in a really, really new Blender, it compares all the little bits and then converts the structures automatically. So if we went from a short to an int, it converts that magically, right? And vice versa. So if you take a really new Blender file and open it in an old Blender, every data that doesn't match in the core in the old file is just going to be dropped. So you can always open your file in the old Blender and the new Blender. So what RNA is, it sits on top of sDNA, and it defines what data types are concretely. It documents them with like tooltips and doc strings. It also gives them a usable range. If you have a short, it doesn't mean that all the values of a short is usable. So you can say that this short is only between 1 and 10, or this short is an enum and it only accepts these values with strings, and then you can, when you wrap that in the Python API, you automatically have the enum values that can be used magically. So it's all fun and games. Context, which I'll talk a bit more later. Half of common lists, probably. And editors. Editors are mostly replacing what used to be Windows. It's mostly a conceptual rewrite. So how do we do that? RNA, like I said, is mostly about documentation. The type system is much, much stronger than it used to be. It's not limited to the C subset of types. It also means we have range limit validation. It's wrapping of low-level sDNA, like I said. And that also means that in the UI, if we tell the UI to draw these properties, it automatically knows what type it is. So it's a checkbox, a range. Depending on the type of button, it would set the limit for the drop, and fun stuff like that. And also groups, so we can say that this property is a vector, so you can have a little widget to set the vector properly. And that's all done magically. We also have auto-generated Python API on top of that, which is parsing the sDNA, the RNA code, and then automatically generating properties and all that kind of nice Python stuff. So basically, the Python property API is not going to be too far from what we currently have, but the type checking and all those nice fun stuff that we want to have if we don't want to crash Blender is going to be automatically done. So we don't have to maintain two sets of API at the same time. Operator API, operators is a very, very, very good idea. I think that's something that Brecht had. So what we do is we wrap tools into cohesive structures, give them a name, give them a category, and then give them declaration of documentation tools options. It's a very good way to stabilize the internal API. That means that all the operators are stored into sorts of lists, like operators that works on the 3D view, operator that works on UV editor. And so we can really know, especially for the Python API, you can know that this operator will work on that kind of data. So what that also means is that we can redo, we can have a much more easier stack of repeat, redo, tweak, and macros. So what's happening in this in that screenshot there is that I use the add cylinder operator. And now, instead of just popping in the parameters there, what's happening is that it uses default parameters, and then you've got that tweak panel there, where you can, in real time, changes the settings, and it changes the cylinder. So instead of having to use undo, then re-add a cylinder, and say, oh, I didn't want that thing, then redo again, undo, you've got the nice tweak thing there. That's also, so you've, it's an instant preview for all operators, and it's seamless for the operator and for the users. It's all done in the internal API. And that's that happens for all the tools. So let's say you snap some big cube to the plate, to the desk there, then you can use another cube, then redo the operator, and it's going to snap to the desk, and then redo and redo, or apply one operator and chain it with another one. So it's a lot of flexibility that we're going to have eventually. It's getting there. Context. Context is a big part that nobody's going to see. Context is a way to remove ugly old globals. Like in the Blender code, we had that nice structure called G for global. G is accessible everywhere, and you can poke bits in there, and that's very, very bad code. If you've got developers in there, you know what I'm talking about. G also, context is a good way to provide data to operators. So if you've got Python calling an operator, then Python will fill the context automatically by the API, and then you can specify what the operator is going to depend on. Whereas if you call the operator from the 3D view, the context is going to tell the operator that it's seamless for the operator. For example, if you call the subdivide operator in Python, you can say that you work on this list of vertices, and it's going to subdivide them. Whereas if you call it from the UI, the context function for selection is going to be selection and not the list. So it's a good way to abstract what operators works on and what the UI works on and what the API works on. 2.5 is also getting a lot of work done in the animation system by Joshua Long. I hope I'm pronouncing his name properly. He's made a new system called Animato. And Animato is this. It's removing all cruft in the animation system. The Blender system with all the IPOs that seems like okay in the UI is very, very bad underneath. Basically what it is, it's for each trucks that you're going to animate, like a mesh. Let's say we animate a position, and then you've got another definition, say, the IPO for object, the location IPO corresponds to this other field there, with an offset on the strict, so it's very, very crappy. So what we're doing now, especially since we have RNA, is that it makes anything animatable in the range that's defined in RNA, and it's doing that by using RNA paths. So what you do is, when you animate something, you specify the other structure and the property you animate, and it magically strings stuff together, and it works really well. So what that means, it also means anything's animatable, and you've got more abstract action blocks. Instead of only having action blocks on armature, you can have action blocks on material IPOs, for example, or action blocks on, well, anything, transparency. So you can reuse those kind of action blocks all the time on your timeline. And also a lot of streamlining for the animation evaluation code. Currently, right now, we've got the dependency graph, which works all right. But then you've got lots of stuff that gets re-evaluated all the time, and that's getting really, really slow on our scene. Animato is going to solve that problem, hopefully. So some screenshots there. One thing that's happening is that we moved away from IPO. We renamed them to F-curves because we're trendy. What that means is it's also a rewrite of the core code. So what you can have is you can have a mathematical function defining part of the curve, and then superpose something on that, which is and keys, and then it all blends stuff together. And you've got curve modifiers that you can specify an envelope, and then the curve will fit that envelope. So lots of goodies for animators. So yeah, basically dope sheet, action editor, and the F-curve editor. And we can see there, is there a pointer there? Yeah. So yeah, like I was saying, you've got the RNA properties there. So on your cube, and the action contains object transform, which is RNA group, you're changing the X, Y, and Z location, which are RNA properties. And then same thing for this other object there. So that's pretty much it for 2.5. When is that going to be released? Who knows? We hope to have a preview for SIGGRAPH this summer, and then eventually it's going to stabilize. You can check out the SVN branch right now, but I really, really wouldn't recommend it for using. Testing only, please. So what we're going to do in the meantime is release 2.49, which is the last stable release in the 2.4 series. Stable, hopefully. It's a release mostly concerned about the game engine changes. So we've got a new version of Bullet coming in. Bullet is the physics engine used in the game engine. It's developed by someone working for Sony, and it's used in the, well, it's provided in the PS3 SDK. So it's a really, really good physics engine. Then we've got video textures, meaning you can slap a video somewhere in the game engine. It's going to use FFmpeg to all drive that kind of stuff. Even using input device, you can use a webcam to put something in the game engine and interact with other people. Lots of API, Python API stability in the game engine. We've got the DOM code, which I'm going to talk about earlier, which touches a bit what I don't remember his name talked about on the first day with DOM projection, but in other side of things, and other goodies, including projection painting. Projection painting. If anyone here used the 3D painting tool in Blender, that's going to be heaven. All right, no more mucking around for seams and that kind of things. So projection painting was coded by Campbell Barton in Australia. He never sleeps. He's a vampire, I think. He's also a good, very good friend. All right, so what projection painting does is you've got your texture brush. It's a bit like sculpting, except your brush is textures, all right? So you paint in a 3D view. It works across seam. It works across perspective. So all the goodies that you would have in a normal projection painting tool, all right? Not only that, but you can also do clone brushing, which I don't have a screenshot of. So for example, you can have multiple layers, like photos of a face, and then use your profile, clone from the nose, and then paint in 3D on the nose a new texture. All right, so you can clone from one layer to another to fill in the gaps and mix textures together. All right, so that's another example using texture nodes. So you can mix texture together and use that as a brush and then paint in the 3D view. All right, so that's really cool stuff. DOM code is based on work by Paul Bourque in University of Western Australia. It was implemented by Dalai Filinto from Brazil, who was in Canada at the time. Long story. It's also work that was done for the SAT in Société des Arts Technologiques in Montreal. So we tested it there. I'll have a video later if it works. All right. So you can do stuff like fisheye dome. You can do env map. You can do 360 spherical panorama. You can do warp mesh. Warp mesh is the most interesting thing because you've got a file configuration that tells you. So let's say your dome is not perfectly square or perfectly round, or it has some weird shape. So you specify everything as a part of a camera. So you specify where the vertices are, what they map to in the UV space. And it works very well for any kind of shape of dome. All right, even like we tested it at the SAT. I think that's the next picture I have. Right. So we tested it there, and their dome is slightly under 180. So we had to use a specified warp mesh. So that's what happened. It's very good. It works really real time. So you just plug your computer in, and then it sends the frame buffer to their system, and then their system dispatches it to the different projectors. So that's where we woke up in the work that was presented on Monday. So we can use our frame buffer, hopefully, with their thing, and then they dispatches it to their camera. So we'll see. All right, so those are a little example. These were done with half domes in Australia, I think. So frame buffer there, and this is what it looks like. The perspective error is because those domes are mostly made that you sit in front, and it looks correct from your point of view. All right, I'll have the video later if it works. Oh, or now, actually. What time is it? I had the videos on my web on my card, but codec things, you know what that is. All right, so that video was filmed at the SAT last February.
Is it upside down?
How do you mean by upside down?
All right. So that's an example of Yo Frankie, the game, for Project Apricot that was shown in the dome. From our point of view now, it looks correct. But when I was actually playing the game then, and I was on the other side of the dome, so the dome looked upside down from my point of view. So that very weird play that way. So that's mostly what it is. The codec isn't really that good. But you can see that there's no seams. The only bugs left, I think, are stuff due to specularity points that aren't correct for every camera. But see, that's a frame buffer we're outputting, and then their cameras, their projector system dispatches it properly. All right. So that's about it for Dome. It's very cool stuff. It's, of course, not many people can play with that, but it's very nice and it's very useful, and people are, woo, Dome, all the time. All right, so what's going to happen soon? Well, 2.49 is going to be released in, I think, 2 or 3 weeks, hopefully, if we can quash enough bugs. I think we've reduced the number of bugs in Tracker down to 25, so the total count of bugs fixed for 2.49 is probably close to 150 or 200. So what we're going to do soon is more open projects. Like, we've already finished Project Peach and Project Apricot, so soon we're going to be jumping in Durian. Maybe, where's Bassam? All right. So maybe Bassam will show you some Durian stuff later if he has time, right? SIGGRAPH this summer. So Blender is going to have a booth there, big booth, hopefully, so we can showcase all the fun stuff we've been doing. 2.5 release, whenever. All right. There's really no deadline with that. Hopefully something next fall. Cross fingers. So all the good stuff's going to be then. So open projects. We've got Durian coming in for actions, monsters. Like, Peach was all furry and fuzzy. For Durian, we want big bloody battles. Well, maybe not bloody, but big actions and explosions. And we're aiming for 4K cinema rendering. That means we're gonna have the same problems that the NBlend guy was talking about earlier. Sorry, I didn't catch your name. So for the composing pipeline, we mostly have to check all the caching and all that kind of fun stuff, because, I mean, right now what the compositing is doing is allocating buffers for all the nodes, and that's really not an option when you're doing 4K rendering, even if you have 64-bit systems, especially when doing full float renders, right? So just more than gigabytes of RAM for each buffers. We've got 3D sculpting tools coming in for Durian, compositing. Sculpting tools mostly because we want to have big monsters with big details and bumps and all those scratches things. Mango is a project I don't know much about. It's a very it's a long-term project. It's going to be about compositing visual effects on real live action, seeking partners as it says. So if you have this kind of project interests you and you've got money, you can give us, right? So contact on and we'll talk it out. And it's always a good way to hype your stuff too. For example, I think Durian, I'm not sure if I can talk about this. I think Durian is, we have a partnership with Philips for their new HD TV. All right, so it's gonna be well. All right, so in closing, I'm gonna show some things done by Promotion Studio in Australia. It's a short they've been working on called Kajimba, which is a really funny short animation project, TV series thing that happens in a bar there in the Australian desert. It's really funny. So when their studio has moved to Blender full-time a couple of years ago. So all the characters, all the animation, everything is done in Blender. So these are a couple of characters they've done. This one's called Bill. He's a mouse. And then you've got Grogan, which is a big lizard, and crocodile, and all that kind of stuff. That's all Blender. Yeah, except he's not as annoying, and he burps a lot.
Which makes him less annoying.
Well, he curses a lot, too. Okay. And drinks a lot. So I guess your mileage may vary, depending on your... All right. Let's show this one. This one's the latest one, I think.
Yeah, another one.
They're also looking for partnership and distribution. So if you're a TV channel in Australia or anywhere around the world, actually, and you want to show this on TV or on the web, like if you're Hulu, well, contact them. Promotion Studios in Australia. They're a really nice bunch of guys, and they do amazing work. So yeah, that's the kind of humor we're looking at now. Oh yeah, this one's good.
I'd go crazy without a cold beer. I reckon if the pub ran out of beer, I'd go bloody postal.
All right. So I think that's about it from my stuff. What do we have left? One slide saying questions. All right. So questions? Anything? Was it perfectly clear or nobody understood anything? All right. Second one? Oh, yeah. That's cool. I think they're going to ask you to have the microphone. Otherwise, Louis is going to be really pissed. This way. And that's Big Bug Bunny. If you haven't seen that, then that means you're not in the 2-point-something million people that downloaded it. So what the hell are you doing?
Hi, I'm really interested in exporting to different formats.
Sure. Are we talking image format or?
X3D, do you know what X3D is?
Yep.
Yeah, I'm interested in what thoughts you have in terms of, what's going to happen in terms of exporting good models from Blender to other tools, but especially X3D.
All right. The problem with X3D is that it's a bit of a, it's a bit of a mixed bag format. It's like everything and the kitchen sink thrown in. So we can't possibly support all of it. I think currently we support X3D for geometry, maybe some materials, and maybe world color and transparency. So are you looking for more support than that, or like animation, or
animation?
I think right now we're concentrating animation on the, that other format called, not FBX, the other one, best one would know. Colada, exactly, thanks. All right. So yeah, because Colada is more used for exchange between other software, like Maya, Max, and the kind of things, whereas X3D is not well supported. I mean, it's a really nice, it's a nice format, but yeah. So I don't think there's any plans right now for animation in X3D. But that doesn't mean that somebody's not going to pick it up and give us a script that works. And then if it works well, there's no bugs, we're going to include it. All right? So can't promise anything. But we have a Summer of Code project this summer for Colada for animation support. So maybe that helps you a bit, or maybe not. And we've also got another project this summer for to solidify the export-import-export API, not leave scripters hanging to their own device. Give them maybe a framework they can work in to have a simple import-export kicking in really fast. So maybe that's going to help you too. All right? Any more questions? Right there. Stanny, oh yeah, we're going to screw you up with Python 2.5, I think.
Yeah. No, not at all.
Not at all? That's good.
I was actually waiting when Python will be available in the 2.5 test build.
It already is.
It's
On the test build, you mean on the graphical?
No, I mean when I can start playing with the
You Python. Can already.
Okay.
I think right now you can build with 2.x series, 2.6, 2.5, whatever. And you can also build with Python 3K. The plan, crossing fingers, is to have Blender 2.5 running on Py 3K only, because otherwise we're going to have to rewrite all the scripts internally. That's only going to happen if Python 3K is stable enough, their C API is stable enough, then to move to that. Because we did a test 2.5 test with that, Campbell did actually, and he went to the Python channel RC with problems with Py 3K, and they told him he was crazy to work on it already. So we'll see by then. So yeah, you can work with it already. It's, I wouldn't say stable enough, but it's usable enough, and the RNA API is not going to change much. So if the only thing you want to do is access properties, that's okay. You can already call operators in Python. That also works well, but that might change a bit.
And the UI?
UI is already defined partly in Python. Basically, it's a callback-based system. So what you do is, in the old UI, you have your UI function, you register it, and then what that function does is define the properties that are going to be drawn, You can, I think, change the UI widget. So if you don't want the default one, you can say this one now is a slider instead of a number, and that kind of things. It already works. I think there's two panels that I think the scene panel right now is done in Python. So you've got example now, too.
Okay, thanks.
So eventually, we want to move this way so people can have configurable UI for that kind of things, and maybe have something like the in-game people were doing. Maybe have some sort of tool work set that you can say, I'm doing compositing work, I don't want these buttons, so use this set of scripts for the UI, and then they have a clean UI with their tools only. Anybody else? And we're on schedule. Oh, yeah. Like, you have a question for me.
I do, actually. What are your plans for your tools that you made, Echeton and Skeletor,
yeah,
which
that
is
question.
A bit of a mystery,
yeah,
going forward in 2.5?
Echeton is already in 2.49. I consider that a preview release because it's usable, but currently I'm mostly concentrating all the changes in other thoughts and design in 2.5. So all the cool new stuff in Echeton will be in 2.5. For people that don't know, Echeton is a bone drawing tool. I could show a video if you want. It's rather flashy. We have it's so flashy that SIGGRAPH people wanted us to do a talk. Well, we proposed a talk and they accepted. Which one can I show? It's good. This one, I think. Yeah, this one. Yeah. All the plans is for 2.5. Skeletor is a bit of a different nest of bees, I guess. The problem is that it's not really tweakable if you don't know where the parameters are. And I'm not really moving forward with that. It's not a dead end, but if people want to pick it up, it works. What Skeletor does for other people is that it's a full character retargeting set. It takes your skeleton, it does a topology graph on the mesh, matches both, and whoop, moves your skeleton to a new mesh. The problem with that is because of the way the topology graph is calculated, sometimes the joints aren't really well positioned. For example, the elbow might be a little lower than you want. The knees might be a little lower if you don't have any bends in your leg, because now if you do that, if the leg is straight, there's no indication where the knee should go, so it guesses a bit. Whereas with Echeton, it's all done manually, automatically, as well. So basically what you do with Echeton is that you sketch a model directly, it embeds the sketch inside the mesh and uses that line as a retargeting loop. So what I'm going to do is, this is Bill, the rat that we've seen in Kajimba, and that's a rig they've used for one of their other shorts, so not much at all. And let's say they want to reuse it. I think that's your finger rig. Probably an old one. All right, what is the finger one? So I'm selecting the template there, drawing on the mesh. It automatically embeds the points inside the mesh, and then we got their fingers. Right. It also does some kind of neat stuff with auto renaming. So if you have fingers which you want to name 1, 2, 3, 5, 4, and it adds the particle for left, right, correctly. If you do that. So you can draw your left hand or your right hand, and it knows which is left, which is right, and does your naming properly. Yeah. So that's it. So come to my talk, Sigra.
Okay. One small question, or because we are now on time.
Yeah, we are.
Okay.
All right.
Thank you very much.
Thanks.